morning. I'm Christoph. I'm working as a team lead UI UX engineering at Trivago. Who of you knows Trivago? Or okay. Is it not working? Or okay. I was asking who of you knows Trivago? Oh, nice. Who already has used it? Okay, we can improve that. So my goal for today is to create a feature on Trivago. The feature itself will not be so sophisticated. It's just in general to show to you how we build a feature from task creation until to deployment. It might be that I do something which is not clear to you. I'm here the whole day. If you have any questions later, just come to me and I can maybe then go a bit more into detail. Let's start. Maybe a bit about the stack first. As you can see, that's the live version from Trivago Italy. This is my local environment where I will work today. It's a bit slower than the live system. As you can see, if I do a page reload, it takes until 30 seconds because I'm connecting via VPN to our office infrastructure in Germany, in Düsseldorf, which is also quite nice. My colleagues are here. I will just write them. They will later do the code review. They're also there and helping me out. So to the stack, as already said, I have set up a very slimline version of the Trivago Hotel Search. So normally, if I'm in the office, we use Docker, we use Vagrant, we use a lot of tools, which also would mean that even booting up the Vagrant or stuff like that would already eat too much time. So I have a very simple slimline version of the application. So you can see it's running on a PHP dev server, which I will use for my demo, also to save memory, because that's not my laptop where I do normally presentations with, and not my fastest machine I have. I have frozen the Trivago price search on, you can see, on November the 14th. Normally we work with 200 people on this application, and you can normally we have around, I would say, 200 commits per day. We release 50 features a week sometimes, or, so there's a lot of stuff going on, and so I had to freeze the application just to be safe. So let's start with creating a feature. I don't know who of you uses Jira or some additional task management systems. In an environment where when with a company with more than 1,000 people, of course you cannot just build something inside the code. There are cross-functional teams which consist of product owners, QA people, developers. And before you create an A-B test or an C test, which we do now, there are differences. A-B tests are normally a test which you run on so basically you deploy 50% on one server and 50% on the other server. But for smaller features, like, for example, changing the color of a button or whatever, that's completely over-engineered, and so we have something which we call C-test, which is a cookie-based test, and this is what I will do with you today. I tested several times. I never made it in time. I also fucked up stuff, and so I'm hope everything will work here. Okay. Let's start with the feature. As already said, we have different workflows. Normally, I would have to use the feature workflow, which I will not, because this is a very, very complex workflow, which also means that I cannot even put the task into review if not another person has put it into review. So therefore, I will stay with the request task. So I will just give it a name, no slides, conf feature. Priority. I think I'd have no choice. It's immediate. Component, it will be just something which is related to the visual appearance of the site. I'm not a fan of this, so I don't add story points here. Yay! So normally a task starts with something. As a user, I want to, whatever, and an acceptance criteria. So we don't have a user story here, so we do an attendee story. As an attendee, I'm super nervous, sorry. I want to see how, that's my nickname on Twitter, deploys a feature on Trivago. Then we also need an acceptance criteria. Let's just write it gets deployed within 45 minutes. No estimates is an invalid number. Shit. Normally, I don't want to play planning poker or stuff like that, so I'll just leave it empty. Hope it works. Great. Okay. My task has been created. So I also have to assign it to me. So, perfect. So what we do now, we go here, and first of all, before that, just in case you are interested, I use Node 4 for building the assets later, which is also a critical step. In general, to the setup, it's very slimlined. As you can see, I installed PHP with Brew. What I need here is, of course, Memcached and PHP 7, Redis, and all the stuff, but it's very slimline. So if I'm working on the office, as I already said, it's a bit more tools and what we use. For example, you can see that some stuff is not working. So here you have normally the missing variable, but for my feature, it will be enough. So what I do now is, first of all, I check out a feature branch. So I'm now in my branch, and that's normally the way how we kick off a feature. So we create a task, we create a branch for this task, and then start working. So still seeing whether this still works. Yeah, it's even faster than at my home. That's cool. I also use another IDE. Normally I use WebStorm, but this eats so much memory, and sometimes it also crashes. So I'm a big fan of this code editor, which is really super fast. So just to show you, that's our base template. You can see already somebody gelled in caps lock here. And that's normally not how a base template should look like. It's way too much lines of code. But nevertheless, it's too much for this session. I just want to show you that this is working. So we write a good morning here. And if I do this now, you should see. Yeah, perfect. It's working. So, next step of my feature would be that I create a feature toggle. So we have something which we call feature toggle, which our backend guys develop. So I'm not so much into backend, but as I did some, I'm having a full stack background, so I'm quite capable to do this as well. My favorite way of writing PHP is copy and paste, as you can see. So I create now the feature class. As already said, I will do a lot of stuff which might not be clear to you, but then just come to me later, because the deployment also eats, I think, 7 minutes, so I have to be hurry up. So first of all, I create no slides conf feature PHP. I create this class, and as already said, I do copy and paste development. We still do a return to here first. Okay, this is wrong. As you can see already, it extends something which we call abstract ctest aware feature toggle. No slides conf feature was it named. And feature name, we need that later. So this would already be half of the step to create a feature. So you have a get function, which returns the feature name, and the other function, which you can later call. At the moment, it's always enabled because I put a return to in, which then tells the system that the feature is enabled or not. What I also need to do is we have stuff like features XML, where I have to place in my feature. As with PHP, with XML, I also do copy and paste development. So, no slides conf feature toggle. So I'm very good at that. The class name is also here. We have some additional stuff. For example, as you can see, this other feature toggle had something like Zeit interface, where you can also react in the feature toggle on locales or, for example, on special types of requests we come in for my feature today. We don't need that. So I will just reload, because if I did something wrong, it will already crash. Come on. Okay, it works. So I did everything right. So in the base template, we would now, we have a trig function. This is trig, our, I forgot to tell you. Our backend system is running on a Symfony. Trig is the default template language for Symfony. We, of course, use Symfony. We do not so much on server side anymore. We also do a lot of stuff on client side, but for this feature, because then I also have to do stuff with NPM, which I also want to avoid because it sometimes, you never know what happens then. My feature was called NoSlidesConf. So get, now the good mornings should still be appear because I wrapped it all into a condition. I created this feature class which always returns true, which means that now the good morning H1 should be still there. Yes, it is. So now we go back into our feature class. And as already said, that's also not the way we normally would do it, but I also have to be a bit careful what I show to you and what not. But in general, it would be exactly the same approach. So there would be a cookie which we read out, and then we know whether the feature is enabled or not. See, my colleagues are here. No. So we always do have a lot of love between our developers. So, oops, this was a mistake. Oh, see, my colleagues are awesome. They are really awesome. So I now created this cookie, adapted this. So when I now reload, the good morning should be away. And no worries, it will not say good morning. So if you can see, it's away. But if I now go here, and I think I already did it. Yeah, I set a cookie. Cookie. Here's my cookie. It's there. So I think that's not really rocket science, but in general, it shows you how it now took me 6 minutes to set up a feature toggle for our application, which is also quite awesome. And it also works for a lot of other features. For example, this, what I used here, is feature enabled. This also will work in JavaScript. It will work in PHP. And especially for smaller stuff, it completely makes sense to do it this way. As already said, if we, for example, change the technology or do a complete redesign or stuff like that, then of course you cannot do it with the feature toggle, but then you have to really have two versions, and which one you deploy on 50% of the servers, the others on the other, other 50% of the servers. So, just looking at my notes. Okay, I did have no notes. Nice. What I actually want to do, I want to do something more cool. I would maybe implement something like a modal box. Why does it look so? Yeah. This is our pattern library. I don't know who of that is familiar with this kind of stuff. So basically, one of our goals is that we don't have to reinvent the wheel all the time. So we have created a pattern library where developers can then just grab code out. At the moment, the CSS and stuff like that is automatically integrated via package, but a lot of the HTML, we haven't found a proper solution now to automatically integrate components from a static repository into our application. So sadly, there's still a lot of manual work to do, but we are on that, sorry. Model box, I just need the code. Should be enough. Going back here. But it would be a bit stupid to just paste the code in here. So what I will do now, I will create a twig file, which exactly has the name of my feature, which is 3.5.1.2.3 html.twig. And I paste in the model box. So now I go here again. And instead of this, I do an include. And I will include the template by search bundle. C test, I still need to see, was it C test? Yep, so now I should see maybe at least the markup for the model box. Yeah, but apparently there is something missing, which is the CSS. I'm just guessing that. Oh, my phone is vibrating. So what is missing is, I have to go to a file which is called IronBase. Funny name. I don't know who have heard of that. We did a very, very large CSS refactoring in the end of last year, which also gave me the opportunity to be on some front-end CSS conferences, and now we have a very modular CSS framework built up, as you can see here. That's the base definition. I don't know who's so much in inverse triangle CSS and all those methodologies from CSS, but you can see we have our settings here, which are just variables. Tools are mixins or some functions, and we have some generic stuff like normalize, elements, objects, and at the end we have components. This component I need now to import is the model box component itself, components, because otherwise I would not have the CSS. Also that, this file is always delivered on page load. Depending on what you do, you would also not load all the CSS directly on page load, but would do it with a more on-demand loading approach. But also this would be just too much for the session now. And now comes the tricky part, because I have to build the assets new, which now takes some time, and normally my laptop gets very hot. We build our assets with Webpack. We also have, you can check it on our Trivago has an GitHub account. We have something developed which we call Parallel Webpack, which also allows us to build assets in parallel and makes it a bit more fast. In general, we have to build a lot of assets. We also have applications which run in right-to-left platforms and left-to-right, so we have some platforms in Israel or in this area where everything is mirrored, and then you have to build complete different assets. So you will later see it when I do the release, and you can also see that it takes a lot of time to build those assets. While they are building, I can maybe continue here. Oh, let me see. Oh, let's wait until they are built. Finished. Oh, just took 45 seconds. So, okay, there is apparently something wrong which I didn't expect to be happen. Oh no. Why is this happening here? There's a Mac switch. What the fuck? Okay, this shouldn't be the case. I will later fix that. Also, you can see that the close button is missing. Here should be normally a close button. So, this is because we also have a new approach which allows us to directly use inline SVGs instead of embedded SVGs, which we had before. So we also have something like an icon tag in Twig, which is also something we have developed. There's also a very great blog article from my friend Radovan. I will just tell you. Oh, what is doing there? Ah, come on. Ah, you want to have a smoke break? Yeah, no. So I will just tell you that I mentioned you. So now I have this tag here. I can remove this. And if I now reload, I should seeing my close button as an inline SVG. Hoopala. Okay, still broken here. But you can see there is an inline SVG. So also the images, the icons itself are also in a package which we call Grunt icon. Then the tag basically searches for the icon and directly includes it inside the Twig template, which is very cool. So now we have to just, this never happened when I did it at home, shit. Now we have to see why this modal box, I think it's the Maxwell thing here. And yeah, okay. So we have to write some CSS and rebuild the assets again, which I definitely want to avoid. But this might also show you something. I still have a bit of time. So I created now the feature toggle for the feature. I also created an HTML file. What I will do next, I will also create CSS for this feature. I'm always pressing the wrong button here. So you can also see that some of our seed tests, which we currently have, import. You can basically see that's what we do a lot, some layout changes, because I normally have the most impact. I'm sometimes really pity for my backend colleagues, because they develop something for whatever, 3 weeks, and then I just change the color of a button, and yeah, this has a lot more conversion effects than some other stuff. Then I also need to create that file. New file. I start with an underscore, so this file will not be automatically used by the STSS compiler. I also start here this whole CSS file with a class name. And then, let me see, what do we have to fix? First of all, the padding is wrong here. Let me find that out. Okay. That's what I'm very good at. That's basically what I do most of the time. So, there was a bit too much padding, which came from the fact that in the pattern library we still don't have the inline SVGs. I just write the important here for the code review so that my colleagues have something to complain about. What I also did here, you can basically see that's a class name, and you will see, this is the live platform, you will also see that class name here. If you can see that, I hope you can see that. So we use this to basically override some CSS which is already there on a C-test context. That's basically exactly the same I have done here. But there is also another file which C-test named, and I am copy and paste development because it's just It's always funny that people always hit the caps lock and write something like this here, but okay. No slides conf. 5138. Right. Okay, if I reload now, let me see whether I'd rebuilded the assets. Okay, it complained here. Let me see. Yay. I don't know what is this big circle in the background. Okay. Nobody has seen that, yeah? Apparently it didn't apply the CSS. Did it apply my class? Yes. But it didn't apply the CSS. No, it didn't. It didn't. So I have to restart npm start. That's the thing which I mentioned to us. NPM. I can maybe already try to fix this thing here. I don't know why this has a max width here. Okay. I don't care. I will just max width 100%. So I will also add this in the CSS file. So let me see whether it has rebuilt the assets. Come on. Okay, before it's doing that, I can maybe also show you why I don't do Composer install. Where's our Composer JSON here? I can maybe show you something like that's our, what I mentioned before, that's our Webpack config. That's all stuff which is used for build our assets, which you can see is already quite complex. That's also the reason why it sometimes takes some time, but now it has built the assets. And I hope it works, otherwise. Yeah. Okay, it partly works. Maybe if I don't have the console open, it's better. Okay, we just live with that. Maybe it turns better out in a C-test, so you have half. This never happened and when I tried it, but no. I'm a bit limited in time because I only have 70 minutes left, and I would really like to show you the next steps. So let's kill that. Let's do a git status. And you can see, I created the CSS for this feature. I created an HTML.twig file for the markup. I created the feature toggle. I added the feature into our features XML file so that the application is aware of that. I adapted the base file where we include then the HTML file and the ctest HTML.twig file just is responsible that the CSS can later work because it just adds the class to the body tag. So what we do now, we just add all the stuff, git commit -m, my broken feature, git push origin, there's a new one. So it's pushed. Now I will create a pull request that my colleagues can go to bed again. And I think target branch, source branch, target branch, right? No slides conf master. Hey, it works. My broken feature. So, create pull request. So, let me see who is all awake, because they all have to work. Janine and Frank. So, I've created my feature in Bitbucket, which we use as our system. Yeah, here you can already see that's now the diff to master. And I will let them know. So now let's see how fast they are. Okay, but I think I can already start with deploying this thing. Because the normal process would be that, of course, the developers would review the ticket itself. While the developers would review it, would approve it, and then as a QA person would merge this feature into the master branch again to see whether still everything is working. And then they would apply it. And this is what we do now. I have to log in into our Jenkins. And they promised me, you cannot, can you see that? Or is it too small? Otherwise, let me know. So the source branch is then our feature. Let me see. They're too slow. No comments yet. okay, so let me just. Okay, that is my feature name. Source branch is the feature, and the target branch is then no slides conf master. I could also try to merge it to master, but it wouldn't work because the master is already 2 weeks ahead of my stuff. So let's try. Hopefully this works. Pending. Ah, it started. Oh my God. So you can basically see what it first does. It starts cloning the repository itself. It's working. Nice. Did say already. Oh, I cannot help. Okay, let me see whether my other colleagues. Okay, they are too slow. Please remove them for it. See? Patty. Oh, my colleagues are really. Yeah, it's not even faked. I have really, that's one thing which is really, I don't want to make too much advertisement about Trivago, but my colleagues are really, it's a pleasure to work with them. And when I basically came up with the idea, when I heard about these conferences, as already said, I do a lot of slide talks and, ooh, what's here going on? Error, YOLO. Okay, it continues, never. When I told them about these conferences and what I want to do, I expected them to tell me, "Oh, you're crazy, you can't do that." And I just said, "Yeah, come on, let's do it. The review takes only the deployment takes only 6 minutes. Let's do it." And when I asked them, "Is there somebody maybe willing to do a code review?" They all said, "Yeah." And I even had 15 people volunteering. They said, "No, come on, I don't need so many." I always felt a bit bad because I normally like to party and on Friday evenings, because we always at Trivago, we always have a party. We have a party room in our headquarters where normally a lot of people stay after the Friday and yeah, normally get drunk. So basically you can see here, I can maybe tell you a bit what's happening here. You can see he's downloading the internet because we use a lot of node modules here. This really, really looks good. Nice. Yeah, but if you want to know more about the stack or something like that, then let me know later. And as I already said, now it's building the assets, which I also did locally. You can see it's a bit faster on Jenkins. It only takes 12 seconds here. And this is what I mentioned before. We have to build the stuff for right to left, which are RTL and no RTL. Let's see what they're writing here. Okay, still good. Let's see whether they found something else. Okay. I miss unit tests here. This is our release engine here. This is. Oh, you know, get. Padding is very important. Okay. Oh, and even it's approved. So this would be now the ticket is even, or two people approved it, which now means it would be the moment when our QA people would really deploy that feature to QA. We are still, in terms of smaller features, we also want to move a bit into the DevOps and that we don't need so much QA, but on the other hand, the application, there are a lot of stuff which, especially I as a developer, even if I write a unit test or whatever, I'm still happy if there's somebody else does some explorative testing on that feature. So this looks good, as apparently the assets are builded. And if it's all done, then it will give me, yeah, perfect, I'm in time. So it will give me then the link when it's finally done, come on. I can maybe also already show you here, if I now remove this cookie again, then the feature will be away. Removing node modules, this sounds good. That's always the funny part. If something doesn't work with the build stack, then you always, people just tell you, yeah, remove node modules and install them again. And also say, okay. When I proposed it and talked to our release engineering team, they really wanted me to do that live. And I said, no, I don't do that live, because I could do with the exact thing, I could also do it live. But on the other hand, when I tried it, as I already said, I fucked up something and I didn't really want to sit here in Bologna on a Saturday morning and fuck up our application. So it finished, successful, perfect. So it should give me a link. Yeah, it gives me a link. Oh, QR code, nice. Why the fuck? So if I am now here, this should now be, if you already see, it's a different URL. That's our, okay. Cancel, I don't know what this is here, just click it away. This is our internal staging system, which already goes, I'm pretty sure, to the live database. And so this is basically the stuff where our QA people then would really test this feature on multiple devices and do some load testing or whatever. And then it gets approved. As you can see, my broken model box is not here, but because also, oh, this is basically what the QA people would not really like to see, but this was because I, there was an HTTP auth which I just clicked away. So I will set the cookie. And if I now reload, my broken model box is there. Okay, it will never go because I also forgot to implement the close functionality. But yeah, I have 6 more minutes. I could now implement also but I think it's just, I think the workflow should be clear. And if you have any further questions and would like to hear something more, just come to me and I will be happy to answer your questions. And I would really know how this feature would perform if we would deploy it live. I think I'm done here, 6 minutes earlier than expected. If you have any questions, whatever, let me know.
Hi. Could you please tell something more about your the flaw regarding how many people should approve your feature before it passes to the next stage?
Okay. That is a cool feature. That's also one of the most important things that we have. We have a very, very great code review culture, as you already could see with this. It was a bit fake, but normally that's also how we do it. Normally it's depending on what feature you do. So if you just do a feature which is just PHP related, then normally it will be a bit more just the backend developers. And other than that, we normally recommend to at least have 3 to 4 people in a code review. Normally it only one person should approve it, but it's always better if more people look on a feature, especially if it's something more critical
Hi.
Hi.
All the developers do code review, write code, or there are specialized tasks that only some people do. For example, the code review of your CSS.
Yeah.
There are people that only do code review, or
on special layers, you mean? So.
For example, you added important in the CSS.
Yeah. Yeah. The backend developers will not care about this important because it doesn't even understand what's the important is. That's what I mean. If you have a feature which basically touches every layer of the application, you normally also add a lot of people who know. For example, this guy who which I just told that the VPN connection is broken. He's an HTML 5 expert. He also wrote books about that, and he's really, really picky with your HTML and stuff like that. And he's also very deep into accessibility, and he will see things that other people might not see. So that's always important that you. It's always good to have somebody in the code review who can oversee the general stack or the whole stack. And it's always important that you also have people who are really into some specific areas, because it also helps. So in general, I'm a big fan of specializing and also of full stack. So it doesn't mean, because some people say you only need full stack developers or you don't need full stack developers, you need both. You need people who are very specialized and you need people who can oversee a lot of stuff.
Okay, thanks.
Hi. How many test environments do you have? You can create a test environment anytime you want, or you have a unique test
you can use. Create if you want. So basically that, with the username, it will automatically, you can see here the price search, and then it's the user, which is my username. And so basically everybody, that was a thing, because it's a very good question, by the way, because in the past it happened that we only had one testing system, and then you had 10 features, and then people had to wait until the feature has to be first deployed to the server, and then you go, oh, my feature cannot be tested, and or some other feature was tested first, and then you never knew which version is now on this QA system, which was, I think, 3 years ago, and it has really slowed us down, and we also grew a lot since that, so we, on this applications are working, I think, around 100 developers, which is not less, and so you have to be flexible there. And
thank you.
Welcome.
Okay. Last one. Sorry, because now there is Catherine.
Hi. Do you do some automatic front-end tests using, for example?
As already said, also with the high amount of multivariant tests which we have, so that's another name for cookie tests, so that you have different variations, for example, of, let's go here, as you can, for example, see, this thing here, when it loaded, this this whole element here, which we call item element, this can have sometimes up to 10 tests. So basically, you can just swap those prices here to see whether it's maybe better or leads to more clickouts, which we call here. And then you could have, you could also have. So basically, it's never good to have more tests or more than one test in this area, because then it's very hard to analyze it later. But you could, for example, have a test here, 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 and then it's very, for something like Selenium or stuff like that, it would completely not, would not work. So that's what we're currently in. We also created a release automation engineering team, which we created, I think, half a year ago, which is currently in that, and I'm in close contact with them to improve that, because that's really a good question, and also one of the things which we can improve in.
Thank you.
You can find, thank you, Christoph.